America, the vote. For this is my country to have and to hold.
Thank you very much, children. You can go back to your seats with your parents. Didn't they do a great job? Growing up on the mission field in Singapore, I was always proud to be an American. There's just something about living on foreign soil that makes your heart thrill when you see the American flag paint the breeze. My name is Stephen Burke.
And I'm Alicia Burke. In the early 1700s, my ancestors braved this new world to make a home for themselves and their children. My roots are deep in the Great Smoky Mountains of Western North Carolina.
We're here on this Memorial Day to honor the men and women who have fought and died to defend our freedom. We'd also like to thank any veterans and servicemen who are with us today. If you have served or are currently serving in any branch of our armed forces, would you please stand so that we can thank you? Thank you.
I wonder if there's anyone here today who had a friend or relative who has given their life in service to our country. Would you mind standing so that we can thank you for your sacrifice? Thank you.
It is because of these brave men and women that we are free to meet here today and worship. We'd like you to do one more thing for us. We're going to sing a medley of the anthems of our armed forces. When we get to your song for your branch of the armed forces, will you please stand and sing with us?
Over dales, we will hit the dusty trail as those pacelands go rolling along. In and out, hear them shout, counter march and ride about, and those pacelands go rolling along. Then it's high, high, he in the field artillery. Sound out your numbers loud and strong.
2, 3, 4,
hi, 2, 3, and wherever you go, you will always know that those pacelands go rolling along. Anchors away, my boys, anchors away. Farewell to college joys, we sail at break of day. Trust in thee, through howling gale and shot and shell, to win the victory. Semper Paratus is our guide, our pledge, our motto too.
Hello. Remember me? I am your flag. Or as I proudly state, the flag of the United States of America. I remember some time ago, it was Memorial Day. People were lined up to watch the parade. The town's high school band was behind me, and naturally, I was leading the parade. When your grandfather saw me coming along, waving in the breeze, he removed his hat and placed his hand over his heart. Remember? And you? Yes, I remember you standing there straight as a soldier, giving the correct salute. Oh, I was very proud as I came down the street. Ladies, as well as the men, paid me the reverence I deserve. Now, I may sound a little conceited, but I have a right to be, because I represent the finest country in the world, the United States of America. What has happened? I'm still the same old flag. Oh, I've had a couple more stars added since you were small. A lot more blood has been shed. But now, I don't feel as proud as I used to when I come down your street. You just stand there with your hands in your pockets, give me a small glance, and then turn away. I am the same old flag, but now I see children running around and shouting as I pass by. They don't seem to know who I am. I saw an old man take off his hat and then look around. He didn't see anybody else with his hat off, so we quickly put it back on. Is it a sin to be an American patriot anymore? Have you forgotten what I stand for? I stand for freedom. And many people have died. Yes, died. So that you could live in a land where you are free. Some of them were friends and relatives of yours. That's who you're saluting when you salute me. So the next time you see me, stand up straight, put your hand over your heart, and you'll see me wave back. I'll show you that I remember too.
God bless lands of opportunity.
I think that hell must be a little like a battlefield. After the fighting and the war has left it, and all that's left is the suffering moan of the dying, falling on the deaf ears of the dead. If you're a doctor, like I am, you don't let it get to you. You harden yourself. Down to the depths of my soul, I turned as hard as stone. That's the way I was the day I found Charlie on the field at Gettysburg. He was lying next to his shattered drum. His left side was drenched in blood. I knelt down to examine him. He couldn't have been more than 17 years old. I can't beat the charge, sir. My drum is broken. Lie still, son. I'm afraid we're going to have to move you.
Is it bad, doctor?
Looks like you're going to lose this leg. I got him back to the field hospital and instructed my chief nurse to prepare for an amputation. But I soon found out we were all out of chloroform. I went in to see the boy. Listen, son, I'm going to give it to you straight. We're going to have to amputate your leg if we're going to save you from gangrene, but there's no more anesthetic. You think you can handle it? Yes, sir. I'm game. It'll be a good deal worse than you can imagine, son.
Yes, sir. But I've got a friend who'll stick by me, and he'll get me through.
So you're religious, are you, son?
Jesus is my Lord, sir, if that's what you mean.
Listen, son, you believe anything you want to. You believe anything you want.
The operation took me 15 minutes working as fast as I could. 15 minutes that must have been sheer torture for that boy. Over and over again, he repeated one phrase.
Lord Jesus, stand by me now. Lord Jesus, stand by me now.
I thought I was hard. When that operation was over, I was drenched in sweat. Somehow I got through the rest of my patients and went home to get some rest, but I couldn't sleep. I just kept hearing that boy's voice repeating that phrase, Lord Jesus, stand by me now, over and over again. Finally, I did something I'd never done before. I got up and I went back to the hospital, and there was Charlie, awake.
Is that you, doctor?
Lie still, son. Save your strength.
I wanted to thank you, sir.
Just doing my job, son. Listen, is there anything I can do for you? Anything I can get for you?
Yes, sir. Would you mail the Bible that's under my pillow home to my mother? Her address is on the inside cover.
Well, I surely will, son. Aren't you going to be wanting it?
Oh, no, sir. I'm not going to be needing it where I'm going. You see, I'm going home. You don't know him, do you, sir?
You mean your Lord?
While you were operating on me, I prayed that he would save your soul.
Well, it's a little late for that, son.
Oh, no, sir. No, sir. When you do accept my Lord, I'm going to be very happy.
Thousands of soldiers died in my hospital during the war. I only followed one to the grave. Charlie Colson. It was windy and I was lonely. And for the first time in my life, I prayed.
Lord, give me the strength that Charlie had. Lord, forgive me of my sins. Save my soul.
Mine eyes have seen the glory of the coming of the Lord. He is trampling out the vintage where the grapes of wrath are stored. He hath loosed the fateful lightning of his terrible swift sword. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
In the beauty of the lilies, Christ was born across the sea, with a glory in his bosom that transfigures you and me. As he died to make men holy, let us die to make men free, while God is marching on.
I can almost hear the trumpet sound, the Lord's return is near. There are still so many people lost, his message they must hear. Father, give us one more moment, one more day, just one more year. With God we're marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. Glory, glory, hallelujah. His truth is marching on.
All history isn't in the books. It's too big for the books. They could make a book large enough to hold it all. There's Valley Forge in Yorktown, we know, and Corregidor, and Midway, and Wake. But that's not all. Those places had their witnesses, their reporters. But for every deed of valor at Corregidor, there have been 100, yes, 1,000 moments of high valor elsewhere, in some hidden spot. Some lonely, out-of-the-way spot the newsmen didn't know about. Listen, historians up there. Whenever man has lived unselfishly, wherever man has ventured to be greater than even himself knew, then, in that spot, there, in that place, man has made of himself the legend which is history. And he does become history if you old men happen to be told, but you're not told everything. I want to show you something, little men up there, a second of history you may have missed. This is a cave. It's not a very nice one as caves go. It's on an island. You'll probably be disturbed because this island hasn't a name. It has a number, just a number, X78. See that fella with a pad of notepaper on his knee? I can't pronounce his name. It ends in ski and has 27 consonants and no vowels. But he's an American, and I'd like to tell you about him. He's 19 today, and he'll never be 20. And he knows it. He's 19 today, and he's got a gun drawn, and howitzers are just beyond his cave's mouth. He's 19 today, and he's writing a letter. A letter back to his folks in Paterson, New Jersey. Folks with the same unpronounceable name he bears. Did you see, Mr. Historian? Just the lad from Paterson with an unpronounceable name. He never got through high school. He didn't like to write compositions, didn't like to read history, didn't like history. But he is history. Or he ought to be, but he probably won't be, because Island X-78 never had a press agent. I want to show you something else, another moment of history you may have missed. This is a foxhole, just a scooped out earthen bed, shallow and open to the sky, a scar on the earth's face. See that fellow with a canteen in his hand? That fellow was of heroic stuff. He came from Iowa. See what he does now? He's forcing the last of his precious white pills, his two remaining pills, between the lips of his fevered friend, a boy whom he'd never met until 8 days ago, a soft-spoken boy from Charleston, South Carolina, who didn't pronounce his words right, the way they do in Iowa. But now that familiar, unfamiliar face is all that matters in a universe rimmed round with nothingness. Tomorrow this time, the American offensive will break through and our boys in the foxhole will be saved. That is, a Charleston boy will be saved. Saved to be sent behind the lines. And our Iowa boy? Oh, he'll be saved too. Saved for a sandy grave beside a shell-plowed beach. I would not keep you from your work, but I would have you look in on an American mother for just a moment before you go. She's the mother of 5 boys. Boys grown to men now, but to her, they're 5 curly-headed youngsters still. Still 5 sleepy little heads to be tucked in at night. And now from Washington, there comes a letter. Ominous. Terse. Official. And from out of the Pacific, there comes a cry, which is actually 5 cries blended into one. And into the heart of a Midwestern mother, there comes a great void. Were you watching, Mr. Historian? Did you know real courage when you saw it? The tremendous courage of lonely places. The calm courage of a woman alone who needs not the hot ebullition of battle to be brave. Put the old familiar names in your history books, drowsed over by generations of school kids. But don't forget that fella from Paterson, New Jersey, who never made a speech for the history books. And don't forget that raw-boned fella from Iowa who never got a medal pinned on his chest or a town named after him or a movie made about him. And forget not, O historians, the mothers of our country, the long-suffering ones, those who sit in silence and quietly fight their solitary battles. There is the valor of Crown Point and Appomattox and Bella Wood. There is the high and shining valor of 1,000 starry names. But there is another valor, empty, unheralded, unsung. The calm, inarticulate courage of Iowa and Paterson, New Jersey, and in a Midwestern kitchen where the dreadful silence pounds in your ears. There is the valor of those who only stand and wait.
Please stand for the second verse of our national anthem.
Oh, thus be it e'er, when freedmen shall stand between their loved homes and the war's desolation, blessed with victory and peace, may the heaven-rescued land praise the power that hath made and preserved it a nation. Then conquer we must, when our cause it is just. The star-spangled banner in triumph shall wave o'er the land of the free and the home of the
September 16th, somewhere in the Pacific. Dear folks, I'm writing this letter in the hope that after my death, it will be forwarded to you. My purpose in writing this is that you may be assured that while we are temporarily separated, we know that we shall soon be joined together with Christ in the presence of God. As I write this, I'm in very little danger, but who can tell what the morrow may bring? We simply trust God to give us the victory. As I pass on, I wish to leave behind me a testimony to the saving grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that God may be glorified in my death more than he was in my life. Today, knowing that I may very soon be called to give an account of myself, I can say that I am trusting only in Jesus Christ, who died as a sacrifice for my sins, that I may have eternal life. He paid the price with his own precious blood, and by simple faith in him, I am cleansed from all unrighteousness. I am now with Jesus, and all is well with my soul. Jesus said, I am the resurrection and the life. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die.
Dry your tears, Mom. Your son has been called home, where he waits to be joined by the dearest parents a boy could have. Perhaps consolation may be found in knowing that when we shall again be together, there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. My life and the lives of my buddies have not been given in vain. We have fought and died to maintain those God-given liberties with which we have been blessed. Now, for just a little while, I would say goodbye. And God be with you till we meet again. Your loving son.
That blessed me. I appreciate it. There's a couple times about tore me out of the frame. Really, I I had to choke it back, because if I'd have started, son, it would have been on. Thank you so much. Let me just share something real short, brief here with you. I mean, what I have is not short and brief, but it will be tonight. Psalm 33, if you turn there in your Bibles. Man, you had me right from where little Charlie was talking there at the Civil War. How many of you in here, you are still, maybe you saw some action, military action, and you still, of course you did not perish, but you suffer from some of the things you were exposed to. Anybody in here like that? Maybe from Agent Orange or anything? Brother Rouse does, that's correct. My father suffers from Agent Orange, just found out he has cancer and had surgery, prostate cancer. And he was an infantry man with the Light Infantry Brigade. And though he did not perish from some of the things he saw, I wonder if sometimes he wished he did, because he saw some pretty devastating stuff that he still deals with. And I do want to thank all you that are in our military, whether you have seen action or not. Just by joining the military, you've put yourself in a position where you could put your life on the line. And I appreciate that greatly. We live in, I believe, the greatest nation on the earth. I believe that with all my heart. Now, it's not a perfect nation, but I believe it's the best one. The Bible says in Psalm 33:12, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, and the people whom He hath chosen for His own inheritance." That first phrase there, "Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord." Our nation, as far as nations go, is a relatively young nation. There are many other ancient civilizations with ancient histories, and our history does not stretch that far back in relation to others. But what a rich history it is. And what a, to anyone that would deny there's a God, our history is a glaring reality that there must be a God, because of how our nation came about, and in just a little over 200 years has become a superpower and the greatest nation in the world. And I believe that is in tribute to those men who were willing to give their lives, but I believe that is because our nation has been a nation whose God is the Lord. And I believe that we each have an obligation to make sure that what those men died for, we maintain and we keep. And the only way to do that is to continue to make the God our Lord. But there's several things we can do to lose those blessings, I firmly believe. The Bible said they're blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. I believe that we will lose those blessings of God, and God will remove His hand from our nation if He has not already begun to do so, when we neglect our God. I'm not just talking about denying Him. I'm talking about neglecting Him. The Bible says in Psalm 9:17, "The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all nations that forget God." It wasn't long after 9/11 where, of course, man, everybody was praying. Even on tavern windows, "Pray for America." Flags, American flags on the windows of cars, and everywhere American flags. And you remember the phrase, "We will never forget." Yet I would submit to you that many of us have forgotten. And not only forgotten what happened at 9/11 and those men that gave themselves, but I would submit to you that many of us have forgotten our God. But no, preacher, no, we haven't forgotten God. Be honest with yourself. How many times in the week do you pray? I don't mean just the Lord bless us food or Lord help me to get out of this ticket I just got pulled over. But how many times in the week do you get alone with God? And I'm talking about have some intimate time with God. How many times in the past week, how many days did you pause to get out His precious Word and read it? Not just a cursory read where you read it real quick just because that's what we're supposed to do. But I mean, you got it and you said, okay, God, I want to learn more about You. I want to read it, God, until it burns in my heart. I believe it was Tom Malone said when people ask him how much of the Bible they should read each day, he said, just read it until it begins to burn in your heart. Psalm 50:22, now consider this, ye that forget God, lest I tear you in pieces and there be none to deliver. You see, when we forget God, we neglect this God that is supposed to be our Lord. He's not bound, He is not compelled to keep His hand of blessings on the nation. And by the way, when it says, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, that doesn't necessarily mean that the man in charge, the president or the senators, that they corporately decide, okay, we're going to be a Christian nation. A nation is made up of what? People. And the only way a nation can be a Christian nation is if it is inhabited by Christians. And I don't use that word lightly. I don't necessarily just mean the saved. That word Christian means Christ-like. One person said, John Adams, he said this, the general principles on which the fathers achieved independence were the general principles of Christianity. Harry Truman said, contrary to what our present president says, this is a Christian nation. When leaving for what would become a lifelong service to his country, George Washington's mother said these words. Listen to what she said to her son. Remember that God is our only sure trust. To Him I commend you, my son. Neglect not the duty of secret prayer. President Thomas Jefferson said, no nation has ever existed or been governed without religion, nor can be. The Christian religion is the best religion that has been given to man, and I, as chief magistrate of this nation, am bound to give it the sanction of my example. Listen to what Harvard University said in 1642. Let every student be plainly instructed and earnestly pressed to consider well the main end of his life and studies is to know God and Jesus Christ, which is eternal life. In 1892, not too far removed in our history, the U.S. Supreme Court said this, these and many other matters which might be noticed add a volume of unofficial declarations to the mass organic utterances that this is a Christian nation. You see, when our forefathers came to this nation, they established it as a Christian nation. Even those who were not Christian respected this word. They honored this word. They saw the value of this word, and it was built on the principles of this word. Listen to what the Word of God says in Deuteronomy 32, starting in verse 17. They sacrificed unto devils, not to God, to gods whom they knew not, to new gods that came newly up, whom your fathers feared not. Of the rock that begat thee, thou art unmindful, and hast forgotten God that formed thee. And when the Lord saw it, He abhorred them because of the provoking of His sons and of His daughters. And He said, I will hide my face from them. I will see what their end shall be, for they are very forward generation, children in whom is no faith. This was the children of Israel, and He said, you forgot me, and so I'll turn from you. Ronald Reagan said this, if we ever forget that we are one nation under God, then we will be a nation gone under. A nation doesn't forget God as a corporate whole until he's forgotten in the minds, hearts, and lives of the individuals. Let me ask you, and you examine yourself, have you forgotten God? Well, no, I remember who he is, and that's not what I mean. Have you forgotten him in your day-to-day living? Do you forget about him when you go to work? Do you forget about him when you get home tonight? Oh, hey, we did our church thing. Well, go home, kick off our shoes, forget all about God. We've traded God's word for the television. We've traded prayer time for pleasure. We've traded the church house for a beach house. We've traded godliness for worldliness. We've traded righteousness for riotousness. We have no time for God, but we have plenty of time to surf the internet and harvest our crops on Facebook. If we forget God, he'll forget about us. And not only do we lose his blessings by forgetting him, we lose his blessings when we neglect righteousness. In Proverbs 14:34, the Bible says this, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Listen to what Benjamin Franklin said. Whosoever shall introduce into public affairs the principles of primitive Christianity will change the face of the world. General Douglas MacArthur said, his history fails to record a single precedent in which nations subject to moral decay have not passed into political and economic decline. And boy, if that was not a prophecy of our nation. To do righteously, it means simply to do right. To just do right. George Washington, in the 1789 inaugural address, said this, the propitious smiles of heaven can never be expected on a nation that disregards the eternal rules of order and right which heaven itself has ordained. Listen, young people, if you continue with the majority of society in the trend of apathy, thinking that nothing's as quite as important as fulfilling your own desires, letting our freedoms and inalienable rights being taken away little by little, and by the way, they are, then the America of our forefathers, those who died for us, the America that many have bled and died to give us, the America where we have the liberty to serve God and worship God according to the Bible and our conscience without fear of persecution, the America where dreams of parents who, because of poverty and inequality and lack of opportunity, are willing to make any sacrifice so that their children will have a chance of real living, the America where lie the dreams of the patriot hating oppression with every drop of blood in his veins so much that he's willing to give his all for the right to liberty, equality, and the pursuit of happiness. This America is going to faint away, become nothing more than just a memory. There are those who died for our nation and for the principles of this book so that we could live for this nation and the principles of this book. And young people, let me point out to you right now, you're our hope. Don't wait and say, well, when I get out of high school or when I get out of college, then I'll serve God. No, we need that right now. Let me move on to the last thing. We lose God's blessings when we willingly live in ignorance. In Hosea 4:6, the Bible said this, My people are destroyed for lack of knowledge. Because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee. That thou shalt be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children. Samuel Johnson said this, the supreme end of education is expert discernment in all things, the power to tell the good from the bad, the genuine from the counterfeit, and to prefer the good and the genuine to the bad and the counterfeit. Hey, where do you learn that? From the Word of God. That's where you learn the difference between right and wrong. Martin Luther said, I advise no one to place a child where the Scriptures do not reign paramount. Every institution in which men are not increasingly occupied with the Word of God must become corrupt. Learn the Scriptures. Hey, folks, I say it all the time. don't just believe it because I said it. I am a man. Study the scriptures for yourself. You learn why you believe, what you believe, based on this book, not based on what the preacher says or based on what grandma said or Aunt Lucille said or whoever said. See what the book says. Know it and then obey it and study it. Here's something Theodore Roosevelt said. Boy, tell me if this isn't applicable to our country today. The things that will destroy America are peace at any price, prosperity at any cost, safety first instead of duty first, the love of soft living, and the getting rich quick theory of life. And boy, do not every one of those things abound in our nation. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. Let's do our part. Let's do our part. Let's not forget our God. Let's not neglect to do righteously. Let's not neglect to study the Scripture so that we can know to do righteously. Let's pray. Bow your head and close your eyes, please. Lord, I thank you so much for...